I think we need to think about, as Patric is talking about, the context of the times that they lived in, and how it was relevant, or how it's relevant to me, is because I think the times we're living in now, kind of mirror some of those desperations in a different way, and how much more so are their philosophies needed, and their stand for me, art for the people, of the people, and by the people, because I think a lot of things that people don't think about as far as what they were revolutionaries, and they were nationalists, and their love for the people was paramount to why they created. And I think what they did was, during this time, this revolutionary time, they were creating a revolution of their own, not only with the subject matter of the times, but also grappling with this thing as African American or people of color creatives or artists. We grapple with why aren't my images worthy of canonizing or being considered high art? So they decided, well, you know, we're gonna get together, and not only are we gonna create work that speaks to the times we live in, but we're gonna create work that speaks to that issue of, this is our aesthetic. This is the way we create work. They were brave enough to leave the European sensibilities, and that takes a lot to do, because you're being told that this is art, you know. And a lot of times, a black artist can get the feeling that they're just finger painting in those institutions. Or you just go finger painting. You can't get a good critique. You can't really get someone to grapple with your images in the same way.
You mentioned that it was brave for them to step out with this. And I'm going to say something a little different, is that they were responding to the environment at the time. One of the things that I like to emphasize is that it was a time period when people were thinking of themselves in the collective. That was big. It was we. Is we. Whereas today, it's about me.
As a painter, and being in those institutions, when you're bombarded by the European philosophy of what is good, for them to break from that and having that training, that's what I mean by brave. Because that's hard to do. Because as an art student, you at these institutions, you're just being force-fed that. And you're not even being taught a lot of times about just the beautifulness of your own culture and how that culture is relevant.
I mean, it's always like a kind of back and forth between the collective and the individual. They didn't totally give up their individual styles as artists, but they did kind of submit their styles to a set of principles that they came up with collectively. And I think as artists, it's brave to kind of let that go, at least, you know, a little bit, or maybe a lot, into kind of thinking collectively. So, I mean, maybe that aspect of it wasn't necessarily brave in the context of a time period in which, like, everyone was really thinking collectively. But I still think for artists to say, like, you know, okay, like, I'm going to let this ego thing go, like, that's in any time period, I think that's brave.
Whole level of brave.
Yeah.
But keep in mind, the bravery of it was not just that we were fighting the system, but we were fighting our families and our parents and the whole rest of the society. This was not a uniform black folks unite and carry ahead kind of thing. You know, we were the kids in the streets who had to go home and get kicked out of the house because your parents were mad at you for getting arrested down on 43rd Street.
One of the kind of principles that's articulated in some of the writings of AFRICOBRA members, mimesis at midpoint, M-I-M-E-S-I-S, which is a Greek word that means, like, essentially realism, like representation in the sense of like reproducing reality in art. It's, you know, it was really important to them to present like African American figures in recognizable ways, you know, so that they're kind of giving positive direction to the to their viewers. I would guess, I'm not sure that the artists would say this, but it seems like there's something about sort of projecting forward into the future. So they weren't working in a social realist vein like the Charles White or Elizabeth Catlett or, you know, some of these other earlier artists who are depicting social problems and asking for solutions, but not actually projecting forward those solutions. And I think that one of the things that's going on with AFRICOBRA is this sort of idea of imagining a direction into the future.
That was the really the mindset of that time period of for those that were thinking revolutionary, they were projecting to the future what should happen, even to the people that were thinking that there should be battles in the street.
And so you're not simply depicting what's there in reality in the time that you're depicting it, but you're sort of projecting an imagination of something that should happen or that could happen in the future. And that's a way of kind of giving direction to the viewer and sort of thinking politically about like what should happen in the future.
You know, what I get from the what you guys were doing and what I kind of try to do sometimes is fuse both of those sensibilities, abstraction and realism or naturalism together.